This is Easter. It's hard, especially not being together on Easter. It could have been a beautiful morning at the Cove. But it is still Easter. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Many of our regular groups at Southminster Church continue to meet, even during this time of social isolation, by meeting virtually. Contact your group leader if you have questions about how to participate. And if during this time of social distancing you find yourself doing any writing or photography or art that you would be willing to share with our church family, you can share it in our new COVID journal. Starting next week, we'll be publishing this as a communal response to the challenges and opportunities of isolation. And you may submit your contributions by email or email attachment by sending them to Leslie at the church office. This, by the way, will be published only within our church family, like our church prayer chain, not to the public at large, unless we ask your specific permission to do so. We also invite you to consider being your own acolyte this morning, or recruiting a child in your family to be the acolyte, to light the candle, to welcome God's presence into your home. Now let us continue our worship with the prelude.
Please join me for our gathering prayer. Lord of life, you are the resurrected one, the one who defeated death. And yet today we celebrate the empty tomb with an empty sanctuary. Now, when those women first visited your tomb, they knew the grief of separation. Well, we too carry that grief this morning. And so we turn to you, God, just as they did, eager to find you not just in the empty places, but in all the places where we might not expect. This morning, as we celebrate your resurrection, may we find your joy in our homes and your peace in our hearts. And let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Because it's Easter. Sisters and brothers, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen.
One, two, three, four.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mind.
Good morning, everybody. This is our children's message today. Since it's Easter, we're going to have a little bit of an Easter egg hunt. But this Easter egg hunt doesn't have candy. It doesn't have stickers. This has something that might be even better, though probably less tasty. What do you think, Thea? Lydia, should we go check it out? All right. Have you brought to see any eggs, Thea? You want to crack that open? Okay. All right. Let's see. Oh, look. It's a promise from God, Thea. This one's from Deuteronomy 31, verse 8. It says, God will be with you. God won't let you down. God won't abandon you. So don't be afraid or scared. It's kind of a weird Easter today. And maybe some of us are feeling a little bit afraid or scared. But God promises that God will be with us all the time. And so we don't need to be afraid or scared. But it is okay to be afraid or scared, too. All right, Thea, what's next? Okay, let's crack this one open. It's another promise from God. This one's from Romans 8, 38 and 39. This might be my very favorite one. This says, I'm convinced that nothing can separate us from God's love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Not death or life, not angels or rulers, not present things or future things, not powers or height or depth or any other thing that is created. None of those things can separate us from God's love. Not COVID-19 or viruses, not weird Easters where we don't get to celebrate with everybody. These things can't separate us from God's love. Hey, Lydia, do you want to find the next one? Can I go find that one? Can you go get it? Can you go get this egg? Get it? Yeah, can you come get it? Open it up. Good job. Let's see what we got. All right. Here, you can have the egg. It says, this one's from Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. It says, don't be anxious about anything. Rather, bring all of your requests to God in your prayers and petitions, along with giving thanks. Then the peace of God that exceeds all understanding will keep your hearts and minds safe in Christ Jesus. Yeah, we don't need to be anxious. All right, Thea, you want to help me get the next one? Come on over, Lydia.
Right here.
Okay, great. You want to bring it over here since Lydia's getting up? Okay, let's see it.
I can get it open.
Whoa, all right.
That just swung open.
Ooh, this one's from Isaiah. Isaiah 41, verse 10. It says, don't fear, because I am with you. Don't be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will surely help you. I will hold you with my strong, righteous hand.
Mama, can you not stand?
God is with us, even in this time. Okay, Thea, I see one more egg.
I see.
Do you see it? Oh, and this one popped out too. This is our last one.
Oh, and look.
Oh, that's okay. Okay, Thea, this one's from Joshua 1:9. It says, don't be alarmed or terrified because the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Even if you're just going from your living room to your dining room to your bedroom to your backyard, God is with you, even there. That sounds like good news to me. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you promise to be faithful to us, even in hard times and strange times. We know, God, that you love us all the same, every day. God, help us to feel your love and your comfort even now, and especially on this Easter morning. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Beyond all measure, that he should. an Easter lament. O God, our God, from the depths of our despair, we cry out to you. From the pit of our fears, we seek your mercy. Hear us, O God, and answer us. Intervene on our behalf. It seems a strange thing to lament on Easter, this holy day of days. We should be celebrating. Where's the fanfare of trumpets, the sweet scent of flowers filling the sanctuary? Where are the fancy hats, the assembly of people gathered together? Instead, we are gathered virtually from our various places of quarantine, our hearts not so much bursting in merriment as they are swelling with grief. Though we gather to remember your resurrection to new life, we feel all too threatened by the reality of death. We are being pursued by a terrifying and invasive enemy, COVID-19. Her fury knows no bounds. It wreaks havoc not just on physical lives, but also on our way of life. The gravity of the destruction he leaves in his path is overbearing. We are trapped, isolated, afraid, worried, overwhelmed, traumatized, enraged, in anguish. And we are bereaved. Oh God, things are not as they should be. How can we sing the Lord's song in this foreign land? And so we cry out our lament to you this day. We grieve that we are not physically together on Easter. We grieve the many disruptions in our lives and the loss of routines. We grieve the lives lost to COVID-19 so far and the deaths still to come. We grieve for those who are ill. We grieve the many losses already being experienced and those yet to come as the fallout from this disaster unfolds. We grieve the loss of a sense of safety and stability, of employment and financial security. We grieve the loss of school and the effects this may have on our children. We grieve the loss of plans and events, physical connection, in-person gatherings, and the freedom to move about as we wish. We lament over the strain on our medical system and the lack of available resources. We fear for the essential personnel putting their own lives and the lives of their families at risk. We grieve the stresses that people are experiencing and fear the toll that might take on their lives. We are terrified about the impact to the global economy. We are saddened by demonstrations of selfishness, racism, individualism, and corporate greed. Things are not as they should be. How can we sing in this foreign land? And so we cry out our lament to you this day, and we also confess. We confess to the part we have played in the carnage around us and to our blindness to privilege and complacency in broken systems. Please forgive us, open our eyes, and empower us to work for social justice. We confess our lack of awareness that for some people, living in this kind of uncertainty and fear is nothing new. Please forgive our unknowing and increase our empathy. We confess that sometimes our hearts and minds become so preoccupied with serving ourselves that we fail to serve others, and that sometimes our hearts and minds become so preoccupied with serving others that we fail to care for ourselves. Please forgive us and help us to love and serve both our neighbors and ourselves. We confess to our doubts and are turning away from you. Please forgive us and increase our faith. Fix our eyes on you in trust. We confess to our own brokenness. Please forgive us and make us whole. O God, our God, from the depths of our despair, we cry out to you. From the pit of our fears, we seek your mercy. Hear us, O God, and answer us. Intervene on our behalf. Like the women meeting you at the tomb on the first Easter, we come bereft, overwhelmed by our losses, confused that something like this could happen, weary and heavy laden. We come seeking meaning and courageously hopeful that like Mary, Mary, and Salome, we too might meet you here, that we would again find you risen, triumphant over the grave. Ours is a heavy and costly hope. It cost your life, and yet it serves as an anchor in the midst of the storms we face. You are alive. And so we can trust in you even as we grieve. We can celebrate even as we lament. Call us once again into the newness of life in you. Amen.
hear these words of forgiveness, which are also words about the resurrection, from Romans chapter 8, verses 31 to 34. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not also give us all things with him? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Friends, the good news of Easter is not only that Jesus is alive, but that he's praying for us and with us. If we lament, if we lift up to God our worries and fears, our anguish and hope, our longings and failings, we do not pray these prayers alone. Jesus is alive. He walks with us on this journey through the cross to bring us to the new life he intends for us all. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and made new. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Amen.
The Lord.
I invite you to take note of the joys and concerns for our congregation that were shared by email with you. And now I invite you to join with me in prayer together. Lord, even on a sunny Easter morning, the memory of the cross is not far away. It casts its shadow over our homes where we are confined by threat of disease, over hospitals where people struggle to breathe, over people of color who suffer disproportionately from this virus, and over healthcare workers and first responders who risk their lives to help us. We see its gloom over closed businesses and the people left out of work, over the hungry and homeless and those who risk their health to serve them, over children who can't go to school and teachers and parents who work valiantly to help them learn at home, over those who have died and the family members who grieve them, over government officials at all levels who must make difficult and painful decisions informed by the best information we have. We pray for these and for ourselves. We bring to you all our joys and concerns, all our hopes and fears, and lay them at the foot of the cross, asking on this Easter morning that you give us not only the hope of new life, but the knowledge and comfort of your presence in this life as we journey on our way through the cross to the new life in Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
What follows is a collection, a montage, if you will, a sharing from members of our congregation of our experiences of the risen Lord. For myself, I most often experience our risen Lord in you all, in all of us, in the body of Christ that we are together, in our fellowship, whether that fellowship is in person or even online or on the phone or in a text message. I experience Christ in all of you. For that, I am very grateful.
One way I have experienced the risen Christ in my life is when he calls me into circumstances and times when I can do nothing but let go. There is peace there, and even more importantly, grace for the messy, imperfect, but by that grace, sufficient response.
My experience with the risen Christ as my Savior and model gives me a reliable yardstick for gauging how I'm doing in this life. If my life continues to move away from self-centeredness toward loving God and loving others first, I know my priorities are heading in the right direction toward a Christ-centered life. Now, I don't pretend to be on track at all times, but Christ will reliably let me know if I'm heading in his direction or not.
I have experienced the risen Christ over many years through the Wednesday morning Bible study, showing the hope, encouragement, love, and grace of Christ as we study God's word to us and then strive to live in all situations as he has called.
I experience the risen Lord at the times in my life when I feel most alone and discover I'm not.
LaVon Mayhew writes that one way she has experienced the risen Lord working in her life is that in Christ dying for her sins, she no longer feels she has to hide the circumstances of her early childhood from her Christian brothers and sisters.
I encounter the living Christ in nature, especially under these fabulous blooming cherry trees.
John Stott, an English theologian, says in his book, Basic Christianity, Jesus' death was natural, but his resurrection was supernatural. That great sacrifice on Calvary's cross gave me new life, because I accepted Christ as my Savior at a young age. I was raised in a loving minister's home, so I was fortunate to learn about the Bible, follow Christ, and continue to grow in my faith. Today, we are going through troubled times. One of my favorite scriptures is found in Philippians 4, 6 through 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. Today, we celebrate Easter in our homes, but we still can proclaim, Christ is risen. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter. This morning's first scripture lesson comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 20 through 26, and I will be reading from the NIV version. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive, but each in his own turn. Christ the first fruits, and then when he comes, those who belong to him. Then the end will come, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed all dominion, authority, and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death.
This winter and spring, we've been reading the Gospel of Mark, and today we come to the conclusion. This is Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices, so that they might go and anoint the body of Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look at the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Please join me in prayer. Lord, in the beginning you spoke your word, and the heavens and earth were created. Then, in the fullness of time, you sent your Son. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. Now, through the Holy Spirit, speak your word to us again, that we may be part of your new creation, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. On one of his Prairie Home Companion radio broadcasts, Garrison Keillor tells the story about a teenage boy from Lake Wobegon who saves a month's worth of allowance, in fact, several months' worth of allowance, to go with his friends to a rock concert in Minneapolis. Weeks before the concert, he goes with his friends to Minneapolis and stands in line all night on a frozen sidewalk to get tickets when the box office opens first thing in the morning. But the next day, his mother begins having second thoughts about whether to let him go. She had read in a magazine article on how rock concerts subvert the moral fiber of American youth, how they contribute to drug use and delinquency and premarital sex and cult membership. Of course, the article didn't mention the particular band that her son was going to see, but she figured they were all alike. She struggled over whether or not to let him go, agonizing over her responsibility to protect her young son. The next day, while her son was at school, she saw the concert ticket lying on the top of his dresser. She was seized by a desire to pick it up, tear it apart, and burn it in the fireplace. She hadn't wanted him to go in the first place. On the other hand, she had given permission for him to go and buy the ticket. He had stood in line all night in freezing cold, using his own money to buy the ticket. What right did she have to destroy it? On the other hand, what if she destroyed the ticket and it saved him from a life of drugs and delinquency? She stood in the bedroom, staring at the ticket, hesitating, wondering what to do. And suddenly, Garrison Keillor said, and that's the news from Lake Wobegon, where all the women are strong, all the men are good-looking, and all the children above average. There was an audible gasp from the live audience in the auditorium where he was broadcasting. You could hear it on the radio, this live gasp and these groans from the audience listening to this broadcast. The next week, Minnesota Public Radio received a storm of angry letters and emails from listeners demanding that Garrison Keillor finish the story. Which is basically what Mark does to us at the end of his gospel. Early Sunday morning, some women come to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body with spices. They discover the tomb is empty, and a young man dressed in white tells them that Jesus is not there. He has been raised from the dead. The young man says to the women, "But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." And then the next verse, verse 8, says, "So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid." That's it. That's the end of Mark's gospel. Some of the early readers of Mark's gospel were so upset about this that they wrote their own ending to the gospel. You can see it in any modern translation of the Bible. If you take any modern translation of the Bible and turn to Mark chapter 16, verse 8, you will see that there are not one but two new endings to the gospel of Mark that were added in the second or third century. But all the oldest manuscripts of Mark's gospel that we have ever found, all the oldest manuscripts of Mark's gospel end at verse 8, with the women fleeing from the tomb in frightened silence. Now, why does Mark end this gospel in such a way? Well, I think there are two reasons. First, Mark wants us to realize that the story of Jesus is not finished at the end of his gospel. That Easter is not the conclusion of the story. There is a to be continued implied by the ending of Mark's gospel. If you think about it, we are in much the same position as the disciples and the women at the end of Mark's gospel. I mean, at the end of Mark's gospel, there is no hallelujah chorus. There is also no hallelujah chorus at the end of our church service this morning. Instead, like the disciples, we are huddled in our homes behind closed doors, fearful of what's going on outside. And I'm not talking here only about the coronavirus. We have many things to worry about this Easter. Unemployment in King County is soaring. Even when the coronavirus outbreak is over, many are wondering if they'll still have a job or a home or a retirement savings account. Or they're wondering about all the other issues that have been pushed aside by the coronavirus. Ongoing issues of critical concern like the future of healthcare, climate change, proliferation of nuclear weapons, or a host of other issues that defy resolution in our polarized political climate. There are plenty of reasons for us to be anxious this Easter. And maybe, like the women at the tomb, even a little afraid. Mark's gospel ends right where we are today. Like the women at the tomb, we've been told about Jesus' resurrection. We have heard the news that he has risen, but we have not yet seen him for ourselves. We have been told that Jesus goes ahead of us. We have been promised that one day we will meet Jesus face to face, but we're still waiting for that to happen. We are still waiting for the day when God's kingdom comes and God's will is done on earth as it is in heaven. We are still waiting for the day when death and suffering will be no more and God will wipe every tear from our eyes. Meanwhile, we are instructed to tell everyone the good news, to announce the good news that Jesus is risen, even though none of us have yet seen him. Which brings me to the second reason Mark ends his gospel so abruptly. There was, it turns out, a reason that Garrison Keillor ended his story about the mother and the concert ticket the way he did. He did not tell us what the mother did, so that his listeners might wonder what they would do. Garrison Keillor wanted his listeners to put themselves in the place of the mother and decide for themselves how they would respond. Mark does the same thing. By ending his gospel in this abrupt, almost cliffhanging fashion, Mark puts us in the position of the women at the tomb. He wants us to decide what we're going to do. Will we believe the good news or reject it? Will we go looking for Jesus? Will we follow him in order to see him? Or will we forget about it and go home and go back to our lives as they were in a fallen world. In other words, you and I are the ones who must decide how the Easter story ends. That's Mark's point. You and I must decide how the gospel ends. Will we seek Jesus or forget about him? Will we tell others the good news or will we keep it to ourselves? One final story. The second book of the Chronicles of Narnia by C.S. Lewis is a story called Prince Caspian. Four British children are brought back to Narnia to rescue a lost prince. As they search for the prince, Lucy, the youngest of the four children, sees Aslan, the great lion who rescued them in the previous story from the Chronicles of Narnia. Aslan is clearly C.S. Lewis's symbol for Jesus. Unfortunately, at this point in the story, Lucy is the only one of the children who sees Aslan. The other children do not see Aslan, nor do they believe that Lucy has seen Aslan. As a result, they go in the opposite direction from the way Aslan wants to lead them, and they get completely lost. One night, when the children are cold and tired, Aslan appears to Lucy again while the others are sleeping. And here's what happens. "Lucy," said Aslan, "we must not lie here for long. You have work in hand, and much time has been lost today." "Yes, wasn't it a shame?" said Lucy. "I saw you all right. They wouldn't believe me. They're all so..." From somewhere deep inside Aslan's body, there came the faintest suggestion of a growl. "I'm sorry," said Lucy. I didn't mean to start slanging the others. But it wasn't my fault anyway, was it?" The lion looked straight into her eyes. "Oh, Aslan," said Lucy, "you don't mean it was my fault. I mean, how could I? I couldn't have left the others and come up to you alone. How could I? Don't look at me like that." "Oh, well, I suppose I could have, yes, and I wouldn't have been alone, I know, not if I was with you, but what would have been the good?" Aslan said nothing. "You mean," said Lucy rather faintly, "that it would have turned out all right somehow? But how? Please, Aslan, am I not to know?" "To know what would have happened, child," said Aslan. "No, nobody is ever told that." "Oh dear," said Lucy. "But anyone can find out what will happen," said Aslan. "If you go back to the others now and wake them up and tell them that you have seen me again and that you must all get up at once and follow me, what will happen?" "There's only one way of finding out." "Do you mean that's what you want me to do?" gasped Lucy. "Yes, little one," said Aslan. "Will the others see you too?" asked Lucy. "Certainly not at first," said Aslan. "Later on, it depends." "But they won't believe me," said Lucy. "It doesn't matter," said Aslan. He got up and walked with stately, noiseless paces back to the belt of trees through which he had just come, and Lucy went with him, laying a rather tremulous hand on his mane. "Now, child," said Aslan, "I'll wait here. Go and wake the others and tell them to follow. If they will not, then you at least must follow me alone." Friends, that's the story of Mark's ending. All of us here are like those women at the empty tomb, like the brothers and sisters of Lucy. We have heard that Jesus is alive. We have heard that Jesus is coming again, but we have not yet seen him. We must follow him without seeing him in order to see him later on. We must follow him and invite others to follow him, because that's the only way any of us will find out how the story of Jesus in our lives finally turns out. Amen. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
And now may the God who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of his eternal covenant, equip you with every good thing to do God's will, working in you that which is pleasing in God's sight. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.